So welcome to the Buddhist Center podcast. Really great to have you again. I'm Kusala Devi. You've heard me a few times on this podcast. I've got the privilege of hosting today, which is great. So I'm here with Vidyamala and Vishvapani, and they're going to be leading a home retreat for us called Entering the Mandala, which is a wonderful title, coming up soon. I'll hand over to you to say hello and where you're at. It'd be great to hear where you're tuning in from today.
I'm Vishvapani and I'm in Newport, Pembrokeshire, which is a very beautiful part of West Wales. And I'm on holiday here.
I'm Vidyamala and I'm in my new home, which I moved to 3 days ago, which is next door to Adistan, a very beautiful retreat centre. And it's very, very beautiful.
It's very nice thinking of you both in beautiful parts of the country. So I'm in Nottingham, in many ways beautiful, not in the countryside, in the city, but there is beauty here too. So we have this home retreat that you're going to be leading for us in September, and the theme is mindfulness and the imagination. So maybe we could just start with why mindfulness? Why a retreat on mindfulness and the imagination?
I actually asked Vidyamala, this was my idea, Vidyamala, although in fact, I think Vidyamala's done many things like this over the years. We did a retreat, Vidyamala and I, with some others a little while ago and really enjoyed it. And I've been a mindfulness teacher for many years, as well as being an order member, a member of the Tri Ratna Buddhist Order. And the approach to mindfulness that I've been following, which is slightly different from Vidyamala's, I did train with Vidyamala, but then mostly I've been teaching something called mindfulness-based cognitive therapy. And that's a really effective, powerful way, especially for people with stress, anxiety, and depression, to learn to be in the present moment. And of course, it comes out of the Buddhist tradition of mindfulness practice, which is about establishing awareness of the body, of feelings, of thoughts, and so on. And what we tend to do with that approach, which is MBCT, is to be aware of thoughts and feelings in a way on their own terms. Through mindfulness, we learn to step out of our thoughts into another space, which is grounded in the body. Then to get a perspective on our thoughts and feelings and all of that that's going on inside, which might be quite difficult. I've become increasingly interested in something else. And I think this has always been there with Vidyamala's approach and breathworks. And she'll say more about this in a minute. But this is the approach of imagination, of the kind of things that we have a lot of in Buddhism, which is the realm of myth, of imagery. A way I'd make the connection is that with mindfulness, I think what we're doing is we're learning to experience ourselves without concepts. So it's a kind of direct experience that doesn't involve thinking about things or conceptualizing. And actually, that's very powerful. You can do lots of things with that faculty, that kind of attention. But the question is where you direct your attention. And so there's another dimension that I don't think always opens up for me in that kind of mindfulness teaching, which images and the things that I mentioned before, they can open up. So that's why I very much wanted to move into a more imaginative space with mindfulness teaching. And that may well be a space that Vidyamala has already been occupying. What would you say, Vidyamala?
Thanks, Vishvapani. Yes, well, what is mindfulness and what is the relationship to the imagination is very interesting. And put it very, very simply, I would say what we're trying to do with mindfulness, very much like what Vishvapani says, is be present, know what's happening, you know, in our body and our thoughts and our emotions. So we're less propelled by compulsive tendencies. And in Buddhism, the compulsive tendencies are traditionally, we push away what we don't like and we grab hold of what we do like. And thus we ricochet through life, bumping into things, metaphorically, obviously, based on these twin reactions of aversion and craving. And that's a very, very powerful training. And as Vishvapani was saying, it's enhanced, I think, through this extraordinary faculty we have as humans to imagine. So rather than only letting go of the reactive mind, which is a very, very important training, we also cultivate a more imaginative, even mythic, sort of archetypal mind, which has always been very present in Buddhism, certainly later Buddhism, very, very strongly present. And I think both those things are really important, like learning what to let go of in terms of reactivity, but also learning what to let go into in terms of what you can call big mind, you can call love, you can call compassion, you can call the imagination. I've always included this in my work at Breathworks, but it's wonderful in this retreat that we're going to be able to bring in very explicitly Buddhist symbolism, because Buddhism is so rich, particularly later Buddhism, as I mentioned. And we'll say a bit more about the mandala later on in this podcast. But I've always loved the imagination, and I've loved myth, and I've loved quite consciously entering more sort of magical states. I'm using that word very loosely. I suppose the knowledge is that this very hard-edged world that we live in, perhaps that's not the only way of perceiving things, perhaps. So we'll be diving into this kind of territory on this retreat that I'm very excited about.
It's lovely, actually, when you're both speaking, my imagination was being sparked. So, you know, talking about a bigger realm or diving in, it is the way we communicate, isn't it? Often through images. It is the way that as humans, we sort of find meaning through the imagination.
I'm just going to add something about that connection between mindfulness and the imagination. And this is also thinking about the different kinds of people who might be interested in coming on the retreat. So some will no doubt be Buddhists and may be very familiar with the way that they're used to working, certainly if they're Triratna Buddhists. Other people may well be coming from the world of mindfulness, and we very much want to make things accessible to everyone, even though we will be using Buddhist imagery. We're not assuming that everyone there is a Buddhist or wants to be a Buddhist. And some of the people, many of the people that I work with, have had all sorts of just distressing mental states. And Vidyamala has really focused on chronic pain coming out of her own experience. So we're both really used to working with people who are suffering in different ways. And I think that the value of thinking in terms of imagination is that it gives another way of framing our experience. There's another dimension that we can open up for ourselves. We both, in different ways, encourage people to turn towards the difficult aspects of their experience and notice their reactions and so on. But what if we can step into a much bigger space than that? Vidyamala calls this bigger container, but there are lots of ways of talking about that. And what is this mind that we have anyway? So often I feel with people who come to my mindfulness courses, on one level, what people are saying is, I'm stressed, can you help me? Or I'm depressed, can you help me? Or I don't want to go back into depression. At the same time, I often sense a kind of yearning beneath that for something in the realm of the soul, a different kind of way of being that isn't just me and my suffering and how can I manage it better. There's something else that I think many of us are looking, and I don't think our culture is very good at providing. You know, traditional religions used to provide that in their own way, for better or for worse, but those often aren't accessible now. So we're looking for something, and that's really, for me, where the imagination comes in. So I'm interested to hear what you think about all that, Vidyamala.
Well, I think in many ways, I agree with you, of course, that the work that you and I do and us mindfulness teaching, as it were, working with people suffering. And I'm also aware, you know, there's another way of looking at mindfulness, which I think is very, very important as well. And it's just awareness. Let's just call mindfulness awareness. I think all human beings need to become more aware. And a lot of us are not very aware. And as soon as you become more aware, then you will be able to have a bit more agency in terms of suffering, but you'll also be able to listen to the calling of the soul, to use your language, which I think is really beautiful. And I totally agree. I think everybody has that longing. That's what I witness. A lot of us don't know how to meet that longing. I notice in my Buddhist teaching and in my breathworks teaching, is when I find language which is a little bit evocative, poetic, symbolic, then people really love it. I think the way I'm seeing it is, how can you be more aware and how can you open up to the imaginal faculty, which is one of the most remarkable qualities we have as humans, and it's often underdeveloped.
One of the quotes that we've been using, I'd been reading something about Sangharakshita, I've been reading some of his writing. And then when we did that previous retreat, you used this image of like we're in this little room and there's this great big space all around it. And I said, oh, well, Bhante says that. Bhante is how we call Sangharakshita. He said, oh, did he? So either you'd come to the same image or you'd forgotten that you got it from Bante. Who knows? And I really like that image because it is reminding me that my mind is bigger, or consciousness, let's say, is bigger. The scope of it is greater than what I experience now. And that's the thing about present moment awareness. We have to have this expansive view of the potentiality of present moment awareness. And then the question is, how can we open up a window or a door or go through it? And that, for me, it's going to be about opening those doors for each of us individually.
Yeah, and I really love the language of portal as well, that we can all step through portals. And one of the things that I found in my own practice, which I found really mysterious and interesting, is if I'm really, really present. So this idea of the present moment, you're like really, really present and deeply in my meditation. The present moment becomes vast, because the language of present moment can sound like a little pinprick. If you're thinking in terms of linear time, it's like it's this tight little pinprick. But if you really rest in the present, something very, very mysterious happens, where it kind of blossoms and blooms into this multidimensional, incredibly spacious experience. So it'd be great to explore that on the retreat, because that's so counterintuitive and paradoxical, that by being fully present, you're not squeezing in just between the past and the future in some narrow, tight little way, but you're resting in something vast and even boundless and luminous, according to the Buddhist tradition, full of color, full of love. So that's kind of mysterious.
I want to do that retreat just to have
well, the good thing is you are, thank goodness.
All right. Okay. Well, should we talk a bit about images? Because I think those are the portals that we're going to be using. That sounds like we're talking about a visual image. And also, I want to bring in quite a lot of poetry and poetic images as well. The images I think we're going to be looking at from the Buddhist tradition, they have a visual element, but they also touch us and affect us in all sorts of ways and using all of the senses. So you are very keen on the five Buddha mandala. I wonder if you could say a little bit about that.
That's brilliant. But before that, I want to refer back to that retreat that we did a couple of years ago with others. And you gave a talk on Wordsworth, because you'd been to the place where Wordsworth had lived, this place called our Foxton Hall. And you gave this talk, it's all about his poetry. And in, I think it's the poem about Tintern Abbey, there were four lines, four images, and I can't remember them all, but one of them was the setting sun, one of them was the blue sky. And I think one of them is the singing air. Is that right?
Yeah, something like that.
Something like that.
And the mind of man. And that's where you feel this deep force.
Yeah. But you had there were these four images. And I was just completely blown away. I thought, I want to do a retreat with Vishvapani on the imagination, because your knowledge about poetry, your love of poetry, and this talk was excellent that you gave. And these four images just were breathtaking. So imagery, I think, can be very, very evocative. And just to stress what Vishvapani's already touched upon, you don't need to have a good ability to visualize. It doesn't need to be a kind of literal internal image, but it's more the language of like the setting sun that's probably going to evoke something for most of us, whether you literally see a setting sun or not. So the five Buddha mandala is a very famous set of symbols in Buddhism and later Buddhism. And I've done quite a lot of exploration of this over the years, and it's very, very balanced. So it's these five different figures, archetypal figures, that represent in some ways the completely unified human experience, or the completely unified consciousness. Each one of these different Buddhas is rich in symbolism and qualities. So one of them is Akshobhya, is to do with the east, to do with the dawn, to do with an imperturbable mind, to do with mirror-like wisdom. He's a deep, deep blue color. And then there's another one, Amitabha, which is with the west, the evening, the setting sun. He's blood red, the Buddha of love. So we're going to be using this symbolism. Like, I've done things like on solitaries, where one time I created this five Buddha mandala out of rocks and stones and all kinds of things in an old crate that I found on a beach. I was doing a retreat in the very north of Scotland. I found this old crate on the beach, and I made this mandala with all these different symbolic qualities, and then I've got candles, and basically I kind of set fire to it and sent it out to sea. And it was just totally amazing. I never forget that. So this is a home retreat, so we won't necessarily be able to do something collectively like that, but we will be encouraging you to have a play with your own way into these symbols at home, not necessarily to set fire to things, of course, but you know, you might want to make a mandala in your garden or something.
I do think that that is a realm that naturally emerges on a retreat. at least if you have that in mind. Kusa Devi, I know you've just been on a 3-month retreat.
Yeah, well, I was on retreat in the Spanish mountains. So I was in a very, very beautiful place where all of that imagery was quite literally sort of very readily available. So big blue skies, vast landscapes, the setting sun, vultures circling high in the sky. All of that just beauty and richness really opened my heart for a start. In my meditation, somehow those images did help me connect with that sense of vastness or spaciousness and openness. Even that ability to have a bigger perspective and not get so tied up in my thoughts. I must say that was also happening as well, you know, of course, like it always does, doesn't it? It's not that I was just sat there without thoughts in meditation, but certainly the images, yeah, they just supported a richness and openness of heart, a connection and a spaciousness.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And of course, there's something about doing that alongside others, that community aspect of practicing alongside each other. Practicing with other people who have similar values or who connect with the things that you connect with. On that retreat, I just several times had this really strong sense of, wow, I just feel really fortunate to be able to be here and do this with my life. There's something about sort of looking around and seeing, oh, and this is what we're all just choosing to do. We're choosing to be here right now. We're choosing to do this with our lives, try and become more aware, more loving, more wise.
That's so evocative, the way you describe that, Kusa Devi. I was just thinking as you were speaking about the fact that this is a home retreat and that we're going to be looking for ways to bring that richness alive when you're at home. So the mandala is one of the images we're using. And a mandala just means a circle in the first instance, but it's really about creating a sense of a sacred space. At least that's what it means for me, a space within which something can happen. If I think about my own practice, then the mandala needs to include being a father, you know, having a family, having all of the household things going on around me. And I hope everyone coming on the retreat will have a sense of including all of that, bringing that into the mandala, but then really reflecting on what it is that is there at the heart of the mandala. What is it that makes this retreat mandala special? How can we bring that mythic element alive when we don't have the support of being in a retreat center, let alone a very elemental space like a remote retreat center in the Spanish mountains?
Well, I'm actually a great believer in home retreats because I think what can happen is if you go away somewhere, you know, you go away, you have your big retreat experience and then you come home and it's like, oh, I have no idea how to integrate this into my life. That can happen. And with the pandemic, of course, we all have experimented with online retreats. And I discovered, oh, in some ways, people were getting more skills about how to bring these great qualities that we value into our daily lives. It's interesting, isn't it? One thing that's come out as a bit of a theme is this longing for a more spacious mind, this longing for more love in our lives, this longing for a way of being that's not all sort of tight and narrow and contracted. And personally, I think we're always having little openings, but we don't notice them. And they can be really ordinary. So it might be, like right now, I'm recording this and the sun's shining through the window and I can feel the warmth on the skin of my shoulder and it's really pleasant. And I can think, oh, I can relax into that rather than just ignoring it. So that's a tiny little opening. It might be that during the retreat, we'll encourage you to find little symbolic ways to remember the qualities of these different archetypal beings. So it might be that, you know, you put a rock on your kitchen counter and that rock represents strength. So that might be your portal. So I think with the retreat that we're doing, the fact that it's a home retreat is really exciting because we'll be encouraging people to connect with these things in their home environment and they'll be there after the retreat as well.
Mm.
So I think the realms that we're hoping to evoke, they're much more available to us than we usually realize. You know, you don't have to be in bliss or enlightened or anything. You just need to learn to notice all these little openings.
Yeah. That's a really good point. And I've done a few online retreats myself. And I think what made the biggest difference was just the intention to be on retreat in your home. So making that intention somehow just transformed this space that I'm normally in around me into a retreat space for the whole time I was on the retreat. And it was great. It was very integrating doing a retreat at home and feeling really absorbed, connected with the retreat material and the practice and the other people. But also then, like you say, Vidyamala, not having to go anywhere to sort of reintegrate or reconnect with what was just around me. having that intention, okay, I'm going to be on retreat for this week, it did just make me much more present and much more just aware, like you say, of my usual surroundings that I might just take for granted.
Yeah, and of course, one's cultivating the great skill of discipline, which can be, you know, really quite hard for many of us, myself included. Learning to be a bit more disciplined in one's home environment about input and so on, that can be very transformative and strengthening.
What Kusala Devi said about intention, and when you have the intention that this is a special place, it is a special place, really what makes it special is the intention. And well, I'll tell you a little bit about how I put this into practice. So for quite a long time, I've imagined the five Buddhas at the start of a meditation, a visualization meditation. And it occurred to me not too long ago to think of these five figures in the different directions of space. What that means is I need to know which way's east and which way's north. And that helps locate me. And when I meditate anywhere, I try and work it out. So then there are four Buddhas in the four cardinal directions. And the fifth one, Virochana, as I imagine it, is in the center, but I imagine it above my head. So it creates a space. And then something can happen within that space. And what happens in a sadhana, which is a traditional meditation practice from the Tibetan tradition, is a figure emerges, a beautiful figure. So then that's contemplating an image. And I think on any retreat, we're doing those two things. We're creating a space. And I will be encouraging everyone to figure out where north is and to orient themselves like that, where the sun rises, where the sun sets, where the sun's at its zenith. But also to bring these images into that center of that mandala and to learn the art or to develop the art of contemplating an image, which is something quite tangible and physical, in such a way that something greater can shine through that image or something in us responds to the image. So you need to find things that you respond to, that you like in an image, that you love in an image. So that's taking us back into the realm of images. Yes, it's a home retreat. So that's really important. Everything has to be in the mandala. But it's a home retreat with a theme. We're looking at imagination, finding our way into that space.
It's interesting, isn't it, that when you were talking then, I got a very strong sense of that because I'm familiar with the symbolism and I'm very moved by it. But someone might be thinking, well, what's the point? You know, why do we need these Buddhas? They all sound a bit weird. And traditionally in Buddhism, this idea of a mind that's freed from the narrow constraints of, you know, craving and aversion and reactive tendencies and so on, this freed consciousness. The traditionally, you know, it's infinite, it's boundless, it's mysterious, it's ineffable, it's beyond words, beyond concepts and so on. So that's all very well and good. And you might think, oh, that all sounds quite appealing, but I have no idea what she's talking about. And one of the interpretations of the Buddhist tradition is that these figures emerged as kind of mediators between where we are now and this completely ineffable, boundless state. Let's just imagine that the ineffable state is like brilliant white light. And then these figures emerge with these different colored lights to draw out the qualities. So they're all different qualities of this liberated mind or boundless consciousness. And when I think about it like that, I find it really appealing. So they're not just sort of images as an end in themselves or because it's a fun thing to do, but they're kind of messengers from the beyond. I mean, how magnificent is that? We're going to be meditating on the messengers from the beyond on this retreat together. Can't wait.
And these images, you know, they're Buddha figures, but they're quite complex. So, for example, Amitabha is associated with the lotus. And that's another way in to reflect on an image like the lotus flower, or if you prefer, a rose or a lily, but just something that's there that has a beauty to it inherently. Coleridge thought a lot about symbols. And there's a couple of ways into a symbol. One is you find what it is in you that the symbol touches. You need to find things that you like, and it's going to differ from person to person. You might like roses, I might like swords or vajras, which is a Buddhist symbol or something like that. But the other thing he said is that certain images can be charged. What he says is they're translucent. So a light shines through the image. By looking at the image, you get a glimpse of that light, or you get a reflection, or you bathe in it. And I think that's, for me, where works of art come in. not all works of art, but a sense of contacting some other dimension of our experience, works of art, works of the imagination.
I think this idea of bathing in light, bathing in a sort of expanded awareness, it massively enriches life when you allow for the possibility that life is more than we think it is, that we are more than we think we are. And the whole thing's mysterious and profound. And over the week, we're just hoping that we're going to create lots of portals for you where you can open out to something more. And then, of course, more just doesn't stop, does it? We get more and more and more and more. And that is the kind of unfolding nature of awakening, as it's sometimes called.
I'm just going to say, I think that is the wonderful thing about this particular image, you know, the mandala of the five Buddhas. This is sort of what you were touching on, Vishvapani. There's so many symbols within all of them. And I just find that at different times, something different will resonate with me. And sometimes that's obvious why, and sometimes it's really not. But if I sit with the image, say the yellow of Ratnasambhava, the golden yellow, you know, if I just sit with that and allow the image to move me, then something can happen. Whereas at other times it might be like, well, I'm feeling a bit, I don't know, not very confident. And so bringing to mind the earth touching mudra of confidence will support me. So yeah, I think that is what's wonderful. There's so many different symbols, and sometimes we'll know what we need and other times we won't. And sometimes we will move towards the image and other times the image will move towards us. There's this interplay.
Yeah. And I'm aware even then you use some words that probably some people won't know, like mudra. Just to say to anyone listening to this, don't worry about any of that. You know, the main thing is that these figures are rich in symbolism that's designed to be accessible. And, you know, during the retreat, we'll be really unpacking it and hopefully making it very accessible to our lives as modern people.
I know one person who's coming on the retreat because she's set aside September as the month of imagination, right? Mm-hmm. She does creative work and she wants to give it space and do her own creative things. But how do you get into that space? Even if you're a sort of, quote, creative person, you know, life gets so busy and we get so frazzled. How do we give ourselves that space? I think that the retreat is going to be about that, because our Dharma practice, our mindfulness practice really should be about that as well. And sometimes less is more, you know, so there'll be input from the retreat, but there'll also be space where we can just notice the little threads that are there in our experience, or the little glimmers of light that flash across our minds, and then they're gone, and usually we don't notice them. So if we give ourselves space and get interested in them, because we're interested in imagination, then something can open up. And I don't think any retreat program can prescribe that. Even the set of images, you can enter into them, but they also need to touch something in you. So I'm really interested in that for myself. How can I inhabit that creative space and doing that with other people? How can we do that together? We'll have a painting workshop or a drawing workshop as part of it. We may have some other things like that.
And just to say, if you think, oh no, I can't paint and I can't draw, don't worry. Don't worry at all. It will just be playing, just playing with a very skilled facilitator, Amita Jyoti.
Yes, Amita Jyoti, yes. Yeah. Well, she's brilliant at that sort of thing. Yeah, let's bring that alive.
Yeah, and I think what you've touched on there, which I find very interesting as well, is to what extent do we create imagination and to what extent do we receive something through deep listening and being deeply, deeply receptive to what each moment contains. And as I said before, my sense is each moment is really multidimensional when we rest in it. But you have to be able to listen. You have to be able to hear the whispers, a kind of adventure for all of us. And hopefully we'll create conditions for that over this week, which will be really interesting. You know, how do we do that online? I'm sure that we can. And it's going to be really a kind of adventure for all of us. And there'll be, you know, group sharing, places where you can meet up with a smaller group of people every day, that kind of thing. So it'll be quite a varied program. There'll be meditation. There'll be these more imaginal activities and so on.
Takes us back in a way to what we were talking about with mindfulness, that the listening is partly to ourselves. This isn't about some kind of fantasy or escape from whatever's going on in our lives. It's a listening to our experience, whatever's going on, even if it is quite difficult. With a sort of faith, though, our experience isn't limited to that. But even then, the truth of our experience can open out into other dimensions. And I think this is very much your work, Vidyamala, how really inhabiting a painful body, for example, that can be a portal as well.
Mm.
But we might need to know where the windows are, some steps up to a doorway.
Exactly. I'm glad you've raised this interesting distinction between imagination and fantasy, because that's obviously something that is important to understand. And to put it very, very simply, I think it's a lot to do with embodiment. So I think fantasy takes us away from our experience. We'd rather be having another experience because we don't like what we've got, which is totally understandable, but it generally just leads to more tension. Whereas I think imagination, we're going inside. So it's very embodied. And to use the traditional image of this expanded free mind, the traditional image is a clear blue sky, which I used to think was above me, because that's being literal. We think, oh, the blue sky's up there and I'm down here. I don't like being down here. I want to be up there, which straight away leads to alienation, escapism, tension. Whereas what I find very interesting, when you really get into the imagined world, it's not literal. So all kinds of mysterious things happen. And I can find that it's like the blue sky lives inside every cell of my body. Or it might be that I'm going inside and I've got the sense of going deeper and deeper and deeper. And then there's the earth, and then there's something underneath the earth. And oh my goodness, there's the blue sky. So the blue sky can be beneath everything. And that's exciting. But you're quite right. You know, I probably wouldn't have discovered this unless I've been meditating with a painful body for decades and been on this journey of, well, how do I both sort of accept my situation, be really embodied, and also be resting in something more of the nature of blue sky mind?
Mm.
And those things can all come together. So we're moving away from duality of body here, sky there, pain here, pleasure somewhere else. You know, everything starts to break down and we just get this whole lived experience, moment by moment by moment, love, spaciousness, expansiveness, connection, which brings us back to this image of the mandala, which is a profound image of integration and wholeness. That's very much what it's about.
And exciting.
Yeah, it's wonderful having this conversation and thinking that there's so many ways we can go on this retreat, and we haven't completely planned it yet. And I think that's good. And even when we turn up, it won't be all completely pinned down, because we'll also be doing the deep listening to see what emerges over the week in this journey together, because it's a shared experience with all the people who come on the retreat, and things will emerge and we'll respond to those things flexibly, hopefully. But of course, we have also got an idea of what we want to do, and we have got structure worked out in its outline.
Yeah, great.
I found that Wordsworth quote, which I couldn't remember in the moment.
Oh, good. So remind us.
So this is from a poem called Lines Composed Above Tintern Abbey, which Wordsworth wrote in 1798. And it's both about what he perceives through his senses in the present moment, but it's also about how he remembers it and how the whole richness of his experience comes into the present moment. And by evoking an image in the present moment, all of that becomes available to him. And also how something shines through these images. So let me read it. I felt a presence that disturbs me with the joy of elevated thoughts, a sense sublime of something far more deeply interfused, whose dwelling is the light of setting suns and the round ocean and the living air and the blue sky. And in the mind of man, a motion and a spirit that impels all thinking things, all objects of thought, and rolls through all things. Mm. Yeah. Wow.
Baggering. Yes. So when you gave that talk, they were those lines I was absolutely blown away by. And I thought, oh, let's do a retreat on the imagination. Because we're trying to do something of that. Obviously, we're not Wordsworth. It's something of this living air and presence shining through. Absolutely beautiful.
Yeah. I think that's a great place to end, really, with Wordsworth's beautiful words. It's been a delight, actually, to hear both of your passion, obviously, for this theme. It's very clear that it's very alive for you both. It's almost coming through the screen at me. I think that'll be wonderful, taking that into a retreat and sharing it.
Well, thank you very much, Kusala Devi, and thank you, Vishvapani. That was such a wonderful conversation, and really hope to see people on the retreat.
Great. So just to let you know the details of the retreat, entering the mandala, mindfulness and the imagination, and it's from the 1st to the 7th of September. You can sign up to that and book through the buddhistcenter.com/live, but we'll have all the details in the show notes, so don't worry about that. So I just really want to end as well with a big thank you to Vidyamala and Vishvapani. You can find out more about their work, what they do as teachers, writers, and broadcasters, both in breathworks for Vidyamala and wise attention of Vishvapani. So the websites for those are breathworks-mindfulness.org.uk and wiseattention.org. So yeah, just a very big thank you. The retreat sounds wonderful, and it sounds like you two are going to enjoy it as well as offering a lot to a lot of people. So thank you very much. So if you've enjoyed today's podcast, then do subscribe on your favorite platform, but also do recommend us to friends and family. I really enjoy listening to this podcast on Saturday mornings when I'm having a lazy morning pottering around the kitchen in my dressing gown. It's just great hearing so many different voices from across our community, and often just hearing about connection, beauty, friendship, and meaning in our lives. So yeah, do join us again next time. Thanks very much.